Okay, the next item of business is a debate on motion 9594 in the name of Richard Lockhead on Scottish Innovation Strategy. I'd invite members wishing to participate in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and I invite the Minister to speak to move the motion for around 11 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to sponsor another debate in Parliament today on Scotland's economic future and the great work that's taking place to shape the future of our economy and country and quality of life, but also, of course, the planet as well. And the publication of the innovation strategy, our national innovation strategy, and the timing of this debate does come at a pivotal moment in Scotland's long and incredibly rich history as an innovation nation. Because we all live in a rapidly changing and truly interconnected world, and the next decade will be one of profound change. And right now, we, along with many other nations, face pressing challenges on climate change, as we've just heard there at questions, and health and the cost of living. And at this moment, we have an opportunity to face these challenges head on and be a global leader for change. We have the opportunity to build on our achievements of the past and to make the most of our considerable natural advantages, to translate our excellent research base into commercial opportunities, and to deliver economic success for every section of the economy in every part of our country. We must harness the incredible power and potential for innovation in Scotland. It can drive our nation's journey towards a thriving net zero economy, encourage further international participation to address those pressing global challenges, and attract further international investment to Scotland. So we have the opportunity to once again take our place as one of the most innovative small nations in the world, to take our place with European countries of a similar size, such as Denmark, Norway and Finland, where innovation is a core driver of the national economy. That ambition is bold, but everyone in this chamber is aware of Scotland's strengths in innovation and the history of spectacular successes that have spawned in this country. We have a proud and enviable history and tradition of invention and innovation, and our people for centuries have been known as innovators, with some of the best scientists and engineers, as well as writers and philosophers, coming from Scotland and helping to change the world. Scottish innovators and entrepreneurs have been solving global problems, whether that's in energy or health or manufacturing and engineering, creative and digital technologies, or a range of other sectors and industries. So innovation is a key priority for the Scottish Government. Over the last decade, we have established multiple innovation centres, as well as entirely new bodies, such as the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland, which represents a £75 million investment by the Scottish Government in the future of Scottish manufacturing, a prime example of how we are supporting industry to innovate. And besides the advanced forming research catapult, its cutting-edge facilities there include a digital factory, a manufacturing skills academy, and a lightweight manufacturing centre. And the vision is to be a place where manufacturing businesses of all shapes and sizes can explore possibilities, collaborate, and find solutions to the challenges they are facing. Yep.
Liz Smith.
Thank the Minister for giving way. Does he recognise that what he's just outlined and the absolute potential that Scotland has will only be enhanced if there is the body of economic policies that go behind making Scotland a very attractive place in which to come to work and to manufacture?
Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that, and that's why I'm so delighted at yesterday's statistics around the attractiveness of Scotland for inward investment projects, which are absolutely stunning. For the second year in a row, we've outperformed the UK and Europe, and for the eighth year in a row, we have been the best performing area outside of London. And the number of projects has increased by, I think, 3.3% in Scotland compared to over six percentage points decline in the UK. That's a great success story. I think we have a lot of attractive qualities that are allowing companies to invest in Scotland, and we have to keep that up. But Scotland is already benefiting from innovation.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank the Minister for giving way. He recognised, though, that inward investment, while welcome as a headline figure, isn't all created equal, and that there are examples. For example, the critique of Silicon Glen by economists was that it was a dependent relationship with multinationals, which very quickly moved to other countries. So can we ensure that we're analysing that inward investment to make sure it's a developmental, deep, value-added investment in Scotland and not simply buying over Scottish companies to assets, strip them and take their intellectual property overseas?
Minister.
That is a factor we should take into account, and that's why I'm delighted with the new phrase I've learnt recently from the tech sectors in Scotland of sticky jobs, because this generation of inward investment projects are different to those that have gone before. They're based around our talent and our university and research capability, and the results, these jobs effectively can't go anywhere else. And they're coming here, they're sticking here, and as a result of that, other Indigenous Scottish sectors and businesses are benefiting as well. And that goes to the heart of this innovation strategy, and I will come on to that. But Scotland is already benefiting from innovation, the success stories across the country, and recognised excellence in a number of areas, both in terms of industry and from our universities. I could give lots of examples, but I think I may not have enough time, but I'll give Kenotech as one, which was a spin-out from Heriot-Watt University and produces the world's first 90% recycled brick. With over 2 billion bricks produced in the UK, the opportunity is really significant to set up further production facilities across the country and internationally. And there's a whole host of other examples I could give of innovation that's happening in Scotland just now. While Scotland's productivity, however, and business investment in research and development have seen significant improvements in recent years, with the gaps to the rest of the UK largely closed, we have work to do to catch up with our international competitors. That's why the time was right to publish Scotland's National Innovation Strategy, and I know that Scottish innovators, entrepreneurs, and our innovative companies stand ready to accept this challenge and return Scotland to a central role on the global innovation stage. Innovation thrives in collaboration, and it's through collaboration we get the most value from our investments in Scotland's businesses and world-class research community. In that spirit, the strategy was designed and developed alongside industry experts, entrepreneurs, business leaders and academics who all came together with a shared vision to once again make Scotland one of the most innovative small nations in the world. The development was guided by an expert steering group co-chaired by Professor Sir Jim MacDonald, whom I thank, and his colleagues, and it was supported by intensive engagement through working groups, roundtables and workshop events and an extensive evidence-gathering exercise. I also want to thank my predecessor, Ivan McKee, who's in the Chamber today, for all his good work in his previous role putting the strategy together and working with these other individuals. The National Innovation Strategy sets out the actions we will now take to achieve our bold vision through the four transformational programmes on cluster building, in investment and in commercialisation and in productivity as well. Within the next decade, we will have a unified network of high-performing clusters in each of our innovation priority areas, providing valuable signposting to attract further international investment, collaboration and talent. The strategy identifies four key areas in which Scotland has the clear potential to be world-leading: energy transition, health and life sciences, advanced manufacturing, and data and digital technologies. We will take a European-style cluster-building approach to support these areas to become world-leading and international-facing, driving mutual benefits from international partnerships as well. Scotland has a range of established, growing and emerging clusters which can act as a foundation for a vibrant, innovation-led economy. Over time, we will develop an approach of tailored packages of public support that act as a catalyst for growth and stimulate further private sector investment to support priority clusters to achieve their potential. We will, within the next decade, also have increased the number of innovation-active businesses, because that's one of our challenges, and nurtured highly scalable organisations to drive forward the economy.
I'll give you a bit of time back, Minister.
Okay, yeah, thanks. Yeah, okay, yep.
Daniel, look, I'm very grateful, but it's an important point, because while the Minister mentions many things, many of these things are where we already do well on innovation. But it's clear from the data paper published alongside that BERD remains a real stumbling block in terms of, and that's about private sector businesses reinvesting themselves. Does he recognise that's an area that requires further work within this strategy?
Minister.
Yes, it does, of course, but actually we're performing quite well with research and development, particularly in the higher education sector, which I'm sure is aware of. And it's also an improving picture in terms of the business sector as well. And internationally, Scotland compares reasonably well with many other countries, but we have got to match the best and improve, and that is an ongoing challenge which is addressed in the innovation strategy. But we also want to adopt an investor mindset to support our most innovative businesses, investing where we have a competitive advantage and providing a comprehensive and coordinated package of support and leveraging in venture capital. So through this renewed package of support, we will place our priorities at the heart of our approach as we increase alignment of funds, reduce unnecessary duplication, and over time close any gaps in the funding landscape and explore innovative models of investment to support Scottish businesses and their clusters to innovate. So within the next decade, we'll see an increase in scaling companies from cutting-edge research and applying innovation to seed the creation of new markets and harnessing new innovations to support increased productivity in existing ones.
I can give you a bit of the time back, but not all of it, Minister.
Very briefly then, and then that's my final one.
You know, this side of the bench understands that the Scottish Government have a misguided attitude, hostility toward gene editing. However, a leaked document suggests that the EU is about to change its approach to align more with the Precision Breeding Act in England. So can I ask the Scottish Government to act quickly to make sure farmers and some of our world-leading institutions in Scotland don't miss out on this?
Minister.
It's always been the Scottish Government's position that we have an open mind to new science, and we pay close attention to developments in the European Union in relation to the issue mentioned by the member and indeed other issues as well. Another issue we have to address is our commercialisation landscape, and we have to strengthen the role of our research base and what that plays in driving economic prosperity in our country. And working with the Higher Education System and the Scottish Funding Council, we will evaluate the sufficiency of Scotland's current investment in applied research, knowledge exchange and also broader research projects as well. So I think, given the time, I will draw my remarks to a close just by saying that this programme will deliver over the 10-year lifetime of the strategy an ambitious increase in the level of innovation taking place by businesses across the whole of Scotland, resulting in increased productivity, improved economic outcomes and a more inclusive economy. To ensure we are making the necessary progress towards achieving our vision through these four transformative programmes, we will track our innovation performance on a number of key metrics over the next 10 years. And we will do that through Scotland's Innovation Scorecard, which will track Scotland's innovation performance over time on a set of key indicators against other nations. So in conclusion, I just want to restate the Scottish Government's ambition, my ambition, that Scotland will once again be known as one of the most innovative countries in the world, leading the world in a number of key areas and providing solutions to global problems. And I believe that ambition is entirely achievable, and I believe the strategy will help us as a nation to achieve that ambition. The power of new ideas and technologies is driving global change at an unprecedented rate and scale. So countries can harness that power. We can thrive in the 21st century. Scotland can become a magnet for talent and investment, exporters of the next generation of products and services, and significantly raise our citizens' quality of life. Scotland can take its place amongst these leading countries. So I look forward to the debate, and I move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much, Minister. I now call on Jamie Halker-Johnson to speak to and move Amendment 9594.2 up to 7 minutes. Mr Halker-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'll move the amendment in my name. Scotland's a rich history in research, innovation and invention, with contributions ranging from the development of the telephone and the television to groundbreaking advances in medicine such as penicillin and the hypodermic needle. And of course, we're the home of Dolly the sheep. And innovation should be a key driver of both economic growth and societal progress. And no one should fail to recognise the importance of boosting innovation in Scotland, both within the public and private sectors, and in supporting innovative new ways of doing things. We welcome the Scottish Government's recently published National Innovation Strategy, because while there have been some notable achievements, there are also real challenges that hinder Scotland's innovation potential. The strategy recognises that Scotland remains below the UK average on all measures of innovation activity, and it recognises Scotland's poor record on productivity. It accepts that Scotland's efficiency in producing spin-outs from research is 50% less than the rest of the UK, and the need to improve the number of alumni from Scotland's universities who have founded venture capital-backed companies. It hopes over the next 10 years to make Scotland one of the most innovative small nations in the world, and to make Scotland fairer, more equal, wealthier and greener. I'm sure many of us would welcome those ambitions, and it needs to be ambitious, given some of the issues I've mentioned previously, and with Scotland's economy facing a challenging future and our public finances unsustainable, thanks to 16 years of this SNP government. It is vital that Scotland embraces opportunities to innovate. The strategy identifies four broad innovation themes to focus on: health and life sciences, data and digital technologies, advanced manufacturing, and energy transition. And the importance of innovation within our health sector cannot be underestimated, particularly with the Scottish Fiscal Commission forecasting that health spending will, in 50 years' time, rise to 50% of our total public spending. Innovation isn't a luxury, it's a necessity. And we debated only a few weeks ago the growth of AI and the vital role that will play. We share the ambitions of Scotland as a global leader in development and recognise the role it can have. But we need the infrastructure in place to make that happen, and too many parts of Scotland are still missing out. And while I welcome the attention the energy sector has given in this focus, it's worth remembering that some of the most innovative work within the energy sector has either come from within or has been funded by an oil and gas industry that this SNP Green government wants to call time on prematurely. And of course, the Scottish Government has blocked the UK Government's attempts to support Scotland's nuclear energy sector, a sector that could have been a significant driver in Scottish innovation, as well as providing reliable zero-carbon energy. Only in March this year, the then Energy Secretary Michael Matheson made it clear that the Scottish Government is opposed to the building of new nuclear fission power stations in Scotland under current technologies. Scotland, which played a leading role in the early development of nuclear, with sites like Dounreay in my own region, will play no part in its future. So we need more than warm words from SNP ministers about the fostering innovation, given the contradiction in approach. And with deep-seated issues that have grown under their watch, such as a rise in economic inactivity and a drop of business confidence. Scotland remains the highest taxed part of the UK, making it harder to attract and retain skilled workers. Our enterprise agencies, which could and should play an important role in supporting businesses to innovate, have seen another year of budget cuts, reducing their ability to provide that support. And in education, we've seen the lowest number of science entries at a higher level in 5 years. The SNP-enforced student cap makes it harder for Scottish students to enter university, and £46 million from our colleges and universities has been cut. Funding, which was promised in December, is now reportedly not available. And this all impacts on our ability to train and the numbers required, the skilled workers we need to drive and support innovation. And I've met with various sectors which are already struggling to find the talent they need to fulfil the roles they have. And while most governments seek a more collaborative approach in this area, the Scottish Government continues to push their obsession with breaking up the United Kingdom, intent on cutting off a vital funding source, one valued by universities and other bodies, as well as putting up a border across the UK single market, which will only create significant challenges for Scotland's businesses to trade and operate. I will.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving way, and I completely agree that we need to look at the broader economic context and things like the study of science. But does he not also recognise that we do need an innovation policy? I just wondered why the Conservative amendment completely obliterates all mention of innovation policy in its entirety.
Jimmy Hawker-Johnson.
I think we recognise the importance of what we're trying to focus here and on some of the changes that need to be made. And the Scottish Government would do this despite recognising in the strategy the role of the UK Government initiatives and funding schemes such as UK Research and Innovation, Innovate UK, the UK Industrial Strategy and the UK Levelling Up White Paper. And only yesterday it was good to see the UK Minister for Science, Technology and Innovation, George Freeman MP, who I met with earlier this year, announced £72 million in funding for new infrastructure, including £23 million for the UK's National Wind Tunnel Facility Network and £34 million for digital infrastructure. And here in Scotland, the Scottish Conservatives' 2020 policy paper, Power Up Scotland, advanced the argument for greater innovation spending and increased direct support for innovation. But it's also important that spending is directed in a positive and structured way. Given the considerable sums of public money involved, it's vital that value for money can be assured. Support should also be accessible while ensuring it remains results-driven. Presiding Officer, I hope we all want to see a successful, entrepreneurial and ambitious Scotland, one where innovation helps provide solutions to some of the real problems we face in terms of cost of living, an ageing population and the climate crisis. But my party believes that successfully achieving that lies in cooperation between governments across the United Kingdom, not cutting ourselves off, that it will be driven by economic policies which provide Scotland with a competitive advantage, not ones which make Scotland the highest taxed part of the UK, and which leave our businesses struggling to attract talent. where proper investment in infrastructure brings real benefits to businesses and communities, not projects left unfinished and promises left undelivered. And when we have a Scottish Government which builds confidence in businesses, drives innovation, not one saddled with a militant green element, which is anti-business and anti-growth agenda.
Thank you, Mr. Hawker-Johnson. I now call Daniel Johnson to speak to and move Amendment 9594.1 up to 6 minutes, Mr. Johnson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, and let me move the amendment in my name before I forget. Look, I think it's really important that we have a clear and ambitious innovation policy and strategy. And I think that's what is also vitally important, that we have a sense of collective mission about that, which is why we will be making criticisms suggestions in this policy. But ultimately, we do support the bringing forward of this paper. I think my main criticism, actually, is that why has it taken so long? The discussion of our absence of clarity and clear innovation policy was identified some time ago. Indeed, I remember the debate leading up to my first election to this Parliament being very much focused on that. So let me bring in, I think, a paper that I have often looked to that was published in 2014 by Nesta, which is about innovation in small countries. And it identified five key factors that a successful innovation strategy brings. First of all, a focus on downstream, making sure that you deliver commercial success. Second, that you have openness, being open to the world, that you have a whole government approach, that you have effective and flexible institutions, and that you have a sense of mission. And that last one is why I think that we have to have a consensual debate. But look, I think what's clear to me is that on the first and fifth, I think the government has addressed this, but on the third and fourth point, around whole government approaches and effective and flexible institutions, I think this paper is found wanting. I think ultimately this is a paper that dodges two big central questions. First of all, is around institutional landscape. We still have a cluttered landscape, and there are only oblique references as to what has to happen to improve that in the strategy brought forward by the government. But secondly, and ultimately, the biggest single issue we have around innovation is private sector investment. And just to take a small issue with the Minister, he's quite correct that looking at GERD, Scotland does have good figures. But if you split that apart between HERD and BERD, on BERD we are behind the UK in terms of level investments and we'd be at the very bottom of the OECD. So yes, we have strong higher education-led research. We have strong levels of innovation, but that fails to translate. Now, I think in this paper, the section on productivity does a huge amount of work because it's the only place where that spillover is really talked about or focused in any meaningful way. And I think there has to be a great deal more work to improve this strategy in terms of the detailed plans in order to deliver on that. But coming back to the cluttered landscape, I think you really only have to look at page 14 and the diagram there. It resembles something that you might see in the opticians in terms of a sea of coloured blobs without any real clarity about who's in charge. Indeed, the paper identifies five different lead institutions leading on innovation. This paper certainly does not set up our version of TEKES or CITRA in Finland. And I think we really need to urgently learn those lessons from 30 years ago in Finland, rather than attempting to paper over the institutional cracks in our own framework. But I think the other key point I would make is that it assumes that innovation is something for external organisations to do. It's a private sector or a higher education sector, but ultimately the government needs to internalise these. I was at the recent Scottish Edge Awards, and one of the winners of that, who has come up with an amazing product to help utilise the use of operating theatres in the NHS far more effectively, said this, that his compatriots, his peers, were saying, don't bother trying to sell into the NHS. It's too difficult. Now, if that is what entrepreneurs are saying, we have got a big problem. That, coupled with the insight that we've seen a massive fall-off in the number of clinical trials in Scotland, what we need is a public sector that innovates end-to-end, doesn't leave it to the private sector, understanding that the public sector ought to be a testbed and indeed a platform for innovation so that we can help our life science businesses grow. But I'd also make the observation that in other areas, I think that the strategy fails to understand where we are. It doesn't deal with the nuts and the bolts. We already have our clusters. They are successful. This isn't about setting up new clusters. It's about getting them behind the ones that already exist. And that's not about doing fancy things. It's about the nuts and the bolts. If you talk to life science sector companies, their issues are around planning, roads, infrastructure. That's what's holding them back from setting up. That's what's holding them back from innovating. But I don't think this strategy deals with that adequately. And ultimately, we just touch on skills. And I quite agree with Jamie Halcrow-Johnson. Unless we deliver those mainstream skills around science, around those key subjects, we will struggle. Unfortunately, I cannot support the Conservative amendments today because I think obliterating innovation in its entirety is wrong. We need an innovation strategy. There are things in here which are good, but it does not go far enough. And ultimately, we do need an innovation strategy that joins up with an integrated industrial strategy. Because unless you get innovation right, contextualised within a good and strong investment strategy, procurement strategy, along with regulation, planning and skills, it will not deliver, it cannot deliver. And that's why we mentioned our plans we launched yesterday, because that is an example. It has innovation within it, research, delivery, and also investment in supply chains and delivery. That's the sort of industrial strategy we need. And I will close there. Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Johnson. We now move to the open debate. I call first Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Douglas Thompson in around 4 minutes. Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scots are rightly proud that our country has long been considered one of the world's most inventive and innovative. John Logie Baird created the first television, James Watt invented the steam engine, Alexander Fleming discovered penicillin, and more recently, Dolly the Sheep became the first mammal to be cloned from an adult cell at the University of Edinburgh's Roslin Institute. The Scottish Enlightenment had significance that reverberates down the centuries, and in this tercentenary of Adam Smith, we should remember his astonishing global contribution. Perhaps lesser known as Dr. William Cullen, a professor of chemistry and medicine from Hamilton, who in 1755 gave the first documented public demonstration of artificial refrigeration, which ultimately changed the way people store and transport food, prolonging the life of perishable items. This example powerfully demonstrates that innovation is a bedrock in which we build the prosperity enjoyed today compared to previous generations, and is a main driver of long-term economic growth. I therefore welcome the publication of the Scottish Government's 10-year innovation strategy, which aims to re-establish Scotland as one of the world's most innovative nations, ranking alongside Denmark, Norway and Finland. However, we should stop referring to Scotland, let alone Finland and Norway, as small. Over half of the countries in Europe are smaller than Scotland, and we have more inhabitants in New Zealand or the Republic of Ireland and are similar to Singapore. That said, I agree with many of the points raised in the innovation strategy, most importantly its focus on encouraging European-style business clusters. Sectoral clusters strengthen collaboration between business, academia and public bodies in areas where we have a competitive advantage. And of course, such clusters already exist in Scotland. Dundee's contribution to fields ranging from the development of ATM machines, comics and video games has long been recognised beyond our borders. The Highlands and Islands are at the forefront of technological advances in areas such as renewable energy and the space industry. Well, Ayrshire and Renfrewshire have a vibrant life science sector, exemplified by the Medicines Manufacturing Innovation Centre at Abbots Inch, the opening of which I had the pleasure of attending last St Andrew's Day, along with Ivan McKee. In Glasgow and Stirling, the knowledge economy has just attracted 500 new pharmaceutical jobs and a £30 million investment from Merck. So with more than 700 life sciences companies, Scotland is one of the largest clusters in Europe, which includes GSK and DSM, two major North Ayrshire employers. Indeed, 800 people in North Ayrshire work in pharmaceutical manufacturing, the highest density in Scotland. However, the innovation strategy also noted that Scotland, and I quote, has a rich history of invention and a vibrant life science sector, but we have a poor record of quickly scaling and spreading innovation. We can and must improve. Government grants can target projects likely to have the most long-term benefits, and research shows that grants will lead to more patents filed by private firms. The Scottish Government's renewed and consolidated innovation investment programme to be published in 2024 will therefore be eagerly anticipated. The public sector invests in business innovation through enterprise and skills agencies. And given that innovation is known to significantly boost productivity growth, it's vital that funding in the priority clusters identified in this strategy remains at a high level, especially in times of budget constraints. Of course, to boost productivity, we need young people. Last week's Economist discussed research which showed that innovation comes disproportionately from young people, particularly completely novel, positively disruptive and discipline-changing ideas. Entrepreneurship is markedly lower in older countries, and Japan's rapidly ageing society has seen it fall far behind in new thinking over recent decades. With demographic decline everywhere, improved education and skills are required to slow the decline in the number of innovative young thinkers. Presiding officer, innovation is about new ideas, technologies and research.
The member is bringing his remarks to close.
Oh, sorry, I was just about to conclude. Sorry.
The member is about to conclude, yes.
All right, OK. Presiding officer, innovation is about new ideas, technologies and research adapted to benefit the economy and society. I welcome that in its innovation strategy, the Scottish Government reiterates its commitment to the scaled development of clusters such as Ayrshire's life sciences, which can have a transformative impact on our economic performance and international competitiveness if underpinned by robust and targeted public sector innovation funding and an eye to how we tackle demographic decline.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Keith Brown. Mr Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I must admit, I opened the innovation strategy with some excitement and hope, but felt depressed after reading the Minister's foreword when he said, too few Scottish businesses are innovating and some of our most innovative companies struggle to scale. And he goes on to say that when it comes to research and development, we have work to do to catch up with our international competitors. This strategy reads like a list of SNP failures over the last 16 years when it comes to economic growth and innovation, below UK average on all measures of innovation activity. Percentage of businesses investing in innovation activity lower in Scotland. Scotland's poor record on productivity under this SNP government. Scotland's efficiency in producing spin-offs from research lower than the rest of the UK. Presiding Officer, if we only had a government that was focused on the real priorities of Scotland, of growing our economy, promoting innovators and entrepreneurs, investing in business, funding our leading universities and research institutes. 16 years of the SNP has left us with a country that is the highest taxed part of the UK and does not have the conditions for growth, but the conditions for division. Is there time, Presiding Officer?
The time would have to be subsumed within the members.
I'm sorry, I can't take that then. In the North East, we were used to seeing huge amounts of innovation, growth and investment, and with energy transition, we can see this again. But for this to happen, we need to stop the demonisation of the oil and gas industry. Historically, energy companies have spent vast sums on research and innovation, and when it comes to energy transition, they can do this again. But they need the revenue from oil and gas to provide them with the cash to spend on research and development. So while we still have a demand for hydrocarbons we should produce in this country, not just to protect the thousands of jobs that rely on the sector, but also to safeguard the huge amounts of cash that will be invested in renewables. Sorry, I don't have time. I will come back if I have time. The strategy goes on to tell us how much stronger we are being part of the United Kingdom with the financial weight that this brings. The UK government has significantly invested funds to drive up innovation and productivity. They have invested in freeports, regional growth deals, which much of the life science innovation in the report comes from. And the UK government wants to go further in developing our nuclear energy capacity, which will bring a huge investment in research and development, but of course being blocked by the SNP Green Coalition. In fact, let's be really clear on the facts here. The SNP have reduced enterprise agency budgets this year, stifling the ability of these organisations to make significant impact in their regions. And the SNP Green government talks a lot about higher education in this strategy, but let's remember that they have cut £46 million from our colleges and universities' budgets this year. This strategy has lots of warm words about economic growth for our central belt cities, but sets out no road how we will get there, and very little mention of how our rural communities will play its part. Presiding Officer, I welcome the strategy and its recognition of the strength of being part of the United Kingdom. I have no ambition to be a part of a leading small country when we can be part of a leading world power with the economic strength that that brings. I welcome the strategy's recognition of the investment that being part of the UK has brought to Scotland at a time when the SNP government are cutting budgets. After 16 years in power, ministers should be embarrassed bringing this strategy before us today. It lets down our rural communities, is admission of failure from the broken SNP Green coalition, and is a clear indication of how we benefit from being part of the United Kingdom. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. I now call Keith Brown to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Mr. Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all know Scotland's wonderful heritage regarding innovation, and it goes far beyond those commonly listed on a souvenir shop tea towel. Just about every town in Scotland can point to at least one major invention or innovation which either happened there or is attributable to somebody from there. And it's important because the past inspires the future. My constituency is no exception, whether it's Sir James Dewar, educated at Dollar Academy, an inventor of the vacuum flask, or George Meikle of Alloa, who invented a water-raising wheel which was used in draining the moss of Kincardine in 1787. In creating our reputation for innovation, Scotland, of course, benefited from being in the vanguard of the Industrial Revolution, although we should recognise, with the hindsight of history, that that was a period of growth built on the backs of the working masses and often involved resource-thirsty enterprises fed at the expense of the peoples of an empire which then covered the globe. But our search for innovation continues, as it must, and I'm pleased to be able to point to a package of investment in innovation and infrastructure that will help drive inclusive economic growth in the area that I represent. Funded by the Scottish and indeed the UK governments, Stirling Council, Clackmannanshire Council and the University of Stirling, the City Region deal will invest more than £240 million over 10 years and deliver innovation hubs specialising in aquaculture, the environment and intergenerational living, each of which will play a crucial role in addressing the challenges of the future. In these centres of excellence, world-leading technology solutions will be developed, transforming the local economy, tackling low job density through the creation of high-quality, skilled local jobs and strong regional supply chains, at the same time supporting community wealth building and a well-being economy. And Stirling University Innovation Park in my constituency was established in 1986. Its aims are to assist the regeneration of the local and national economies by providing an environment that facilitates, encourages and promotes businesses with a focus on innovation. And these are the kind of projects that the National Innovation Strategy outlined in the motion can and must support and promote. The new fields of knowledge in which the future of our planet will depend need the same explosion of innovation that the Industrial Revolution brought about. And it's essential that Scotland is to the forefront of this new revolution. To play our part, admittedly, in repairing the climatic and economic harms caused by global industrialisation. Arthur Herman of the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C. wrote a book published in 2001 entitled How the Scots Invented the Modern World. As the Scotsman reviewer said at the time, the overblown rhetoric invites a sceptical reaction, but I suggest we just accept this extraordinary compliment graciously. The important thing now for ourselves and as our continued contribution to the world is that we continue our love of knowledge, our support for innovation and play a leading role in the development of the postmodern world. We could talk about the almost unique achievement of Scotland's universities. The last time I heard, I think, five in the top 200 in the world. And that explosion of ideas during the Scottish Enlightenment is also an inspiration. Perhaps you won't see the Boris Johnson School of Philosophy on the Nature of Truth or the quasi-quartile political economy thesis put forward, but there are very important antecedents which should inform how we look forward and also give us inspiration to say that Scotland can lead again. And there's a wider message here too. If we are determined to become a world leader in entrepreneurship and innovation, then we have to reverse the isolationist approach. I know it's very uncomfortable for some Conservative members to hear this, but we have to reverse the isolationist approach that's been thrust upon us as part of Brexit Britain. Scotland must use all the powers we have to create an economy which supports businesses to thrive. And we'll do this by harnessing the skills and the ingenuity of our people and seizing the economic and social opportunities provided, not as part of some delusion about a world power, but we do it best with the normal powers of an independent nation. I support the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Co-Cab Stewart. Mr. Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to follow Keith Brown and his analysis, particularly of industrialisation and, of course, that so many of our communities have at their heart individuals that have done so much. But I'd also like to extend that to the significant number of communities that have at their heart evidence of the effects of the industrialisation, and I think particularly of Preston Grange, close to where I live, which,
as an industrial centre shows not just decades, but hundreds of years of industrialisation, from glassmaking all the way through to brickmaking and, of course, coal mining. But also, to pick up on one of Keith Brown's comments, it is also about the damage that actually was rendered to those communities that gave so much in the creation of that industrialisation. And I do welcome much of the Scottish Government's strategy on this, and in particular, the four key areas of the economy that have been identified. And I would like to take the opportunity just to pick out a couple of them to raise some questions and comment. The first with regard to advanced manufacturing. Now, I'm going to draw on energy production, as I would feel almost disappointed if the Minister didn't realise I was going to do this, because our history, our identity, indeed our politics, is often wrapped up in the story of energy, of where it's come from, how it's moved, how much does it cost, and again, who has benefited. And we do need to build the skills, the talent and the expertise that's already abundant in our energy sector if we are to forge forward to a just, equitable green transition. And I do make mention of Torness Nuclear Power Station near Dunbar in East Lothian, south of Scotland. Over 500 people employed directly, bringing in £50 million in wages a year for the community. Over 200 jobs in the contracting workforce that surrounds it, driving another tens of millions more into the local authority. And with that workforce, on some days, through just one-tenth of a square mile, half the energy needs of this country are produced. And I do think that it is still short-sighted for the Scottish Government to close its eyes to the potential of nuclear power, be it small modular nuclear reactors or others, to give us a green future that will allow that base load that's such a requirement of the energy systems that surround us. In the short time I have, I'd also like to pick up on the health and life science, which has been commented on already. Scotland should be a world leader in healthcare. We need to lead in healthcare innovation, and we have, with the UK government, one of the finest databases you can find in the world to allow the role of AI, which I know we've debated within this chamber in the recent past. But we have a database that is invaluable if we can work out access to it and the return that our NHS, and indeed through our NHS, each individual patient should see for access to that. And that is a powerful prize to look towards with a requirement to work together. But as Daniel Johnson has already stated, this future is not just one of words that could be the result of this strategy, but it requires planning, it requires the infrastructure, it requires the joined up thinking, it requires the Scottish Government to do something which, with respect, I feel it has struggled to do, and that is work, not just talk with our communities, to work with our businesses, not just talk to them, to work with our universities and college sectors, to work with the UK government, to work with other governments around the world, to drive forward what I know Scotland can produce, which is a confident, innovative future that supports our people. I'm grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. I now call Cocab Stewart to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Ms. Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a small, outward-looking nation, Scotland is uniquely placed to punch well above its weight when it comes to innovation. And we are blessed with a reputation for producing some of the greatest trailblazers and revolutionary thinkers the world has ever seen, from David Hume to Peter Higgs, from Rabbi Burns to Robbie Coltrane. It follows that the Scottish Government's newly published innovation strategy is an ambitious document with a clear vision that we prosper and thrive alongside other small, successful nations. Whilst there is much to unpack in this 10-year plan, I am drawn to the emphasis on collaboration. From the primary classroom, where children design and build alternative robust housing structures to help out the three little pigs, to the science labs and the universities collaborating across sectors. It is so important that research and innovation is fruitful, translating into a tangible end product that ultimately benefits our society and delivers sustainable growth for our economy. And as an example of that collaborative working, I recall during the pandemic when students from the University of Glasgow were involved in designing face masks, teamed up with a small business in Stirling, The result was the creation of a better-looking and better-fitting product. It's perhaps worth mentioning that the University of Glasgow is also highlighted in this strategy on account of its exciting partnership with the Scottish Enterprise and Glasgow City Council to create the Glasgow Riverside Innovation District, or GRID. GRID will act as Scotland's first whole system innovation demonstrator, a district that is home to world-leading clinical innovation zone, as well as the emerging cultural quarter based around the Kelvin Grove Museum and Art Gallery, the Scottish Events Campus, and the Media Hub at Pacific Quay. Increasing channels of communication and collaboration between a range of sectors with diverse skill sets is a bold and welcome move that has the potential to push Glasgow further to the forefront of international industry and innovation. The University of Strathclyde is also currently sitting at the pinnacle of world-class research and innovation. And as mentioned previously by members, we are very grateful to the Minister, Richard Lockhead, and to Ivan Meakey before him for co-chairing the creation of the strategy with the university's principal, Professor Sir Jim MacDonald. The university's success in collaboration with student startups has been showcased by recent breakout stars like Bellrock Technology, an award-winning software company that allows electrical power sector to use its data more effectively. And of course, the M Squared Lasers, which grew from a Strathclyde spin-out company and is now anchoring the quantum industry, an industry which is growing quickly in Scotland. Each of these stories tell us what we already know. The talent is there, but we need to harness it and we need to create a clear path for it to flourish. Now, I've had the pleasure to meet Mohamed Rashid Iftikhar, a pre- and post-disaster scientist, an inventor of the world's first AI vehicle property fire or flood damage mitigation system. This was showcased during COP26. Think of the transformational effect of this technology in flood risk areas across Scotland and the world. Now, I realise how lucky I am to represent a city and a constituency which boasts a long history of innovative success. From the television to the refrigerator, antiseptics, beta blockers, and let's not forget a creation so influential, so controversial, that it still shocks me to my very core, the chicken tikka masala. In closing, Presiding Officer, there is much to be envied in our little powerhouse of a nation. I look forward to seeing how this strategy provides not only the chance to create future jobs in traditional and new emerging sectors, but will open up spaces for conversations that can pave the way to a more inclusive marketplace. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Ivan Meakey. Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland has a long and proud history of supporting and nurturing innovators, and I know that we do all agree we want to continue being an innovative nation. At a time of the twin crises of climate and nature, of increasing global uncertainty and rising inequalities, it is perhaps more important than ever to ensure that we do work towards innovation for a purpose. That purpose being the development of a greener, fairer, well-being economy that sustains healthy and happy communities across our country. We must have a strong topical emphasis on the structural challenges in our society, which innovations in all four key areas identified in the strategy should seek to address. Others have already spoken about the four priority areas highlighted, so I won't rehearse those in the time I've got. I do, however, want to say a little bit about what we mean by innovation. Innovation has that nebulous quality of generally being seen as a good thing. Innovation is driven by change or new knowledge. So, as we look at the crises we face, we need to consider what is changing. And of course, one of the obvious ones is technology. And we need to consider how knowledge develops. We then need to understand the intersection between the things that have changed or the things that we have newly discovered and existing processes. The valuable thing about innovation is quite simple. Setting out the problems or issues, what technologies or knowledge we have now that we didn't have previously, and working out how these can aid us in dealing with the problem or challenge previously identified. And let's be clear, Innovation is not just something that happens in the private sector, done by the wealthy and focused on digital and new technology, although that is often where the focus is. The challenges we face cannot be limited to those who have traditionally been associated with this approach. Rather, innovation requires the application of our collective creativity, intelligence, and insight to address the problems of climate breakdown, COVID recovery, and social isolation, to name just three. Mariana Mazzucato has very clearly set out how innovation does not stem from the wealthy folk in Silicon Valley, but rather is driven by public sector research and investment. Her eye-catching observation that almost all of the technology in the iPhone, for instance, results from publicly funded innovation, that is something we must remember. Her proposed solution to the problem that we have in how to focus our innovation investment is to develop missions and challenges that we can turn the attention, ability, and insight of our citizens to addressing. We have to be clear what these missions are and what the challenges that sit within them are, how we define them, so we can innovate as effectively as possible with maximum impact for our citizens and our communities. Innovation with purpose. In 2021, and in different ways more recently, I was pleased to see the Cabinet Secretaries given responsibilities for two of the more important missions that I think we must address, net zero and COVID recovery. This speaks to the recognition that challenges we face are not neatly contained in discrete departments. I welcome this approach, and even the European Commission, not an institution known for its embrace of new or dynamic ways of working, has adopted the same approach too. So our approach to innovation must go beyond a focus on private sector innovation. We must mobilise our public institutions and our communities. We need a broad-based approach that gives everybody a clear target and aligns institutions with citizens and communities towards addressing those targets. Because the real value in innovation is when it is focused on social purpose. And we must ensure that our innovation is embedded in a broader industrial strategy. We know that manufacturing is often the locus for significant innovation. We have centuries of evidence to back that up. So we have to rekindle Scotland's manufacturing potential, and there is loads of that potential, particularly if we think of the opportunities in local supply chains.
Ms Chapman, I need to ask you to get over your time. Please conclude.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. Supply chains for the renewable industry. In closing, if we get all of this right, the real beneficiaries will be Scottish businesses, entrepreneurs, workers, communities and universities.
Ms Chapman, you need to conclude, please.
All.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I remind members that speeches of up to 4 minutes? I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Murdo Fraser. Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to be speaking in this debate this afternoon and delighted to see the strategy coming forward, critical and central as it is to development of Scotland's economy. It's been widely anticipated and a great number of people were involved in putting it together. It's received very positive response from across industry and universities as a consequence. And I think the key objective for the strategy is to further commercialise the world-leading research coming out of Scotland's universities, because it's recognised that tackling that challenge is absolutely critical. We've got some great numbers in improving on start-ups and spin-outs, but it's that commercialisation to scale piece that's the bit that needs the most focus. But also alongside that, ensuring wider diffusion of innovation across the wider base of businesses, SMEs in particular, and also driving up innovation in the public sector. The strategy identifies what needs to be done, but I think the hard work really just starts now, because taking forward the programmes that have been defined, tracking progress against those actions and making sure they are delivered in the months and years ahead is what will drive forward what needs to happen across Scotland's innovation ecosystem. And if this sits on a shelf, then we're absolutely going to fail to do that. So it's really important that this is grasped and driven forward by government going forward. I just want to highlight a couple of points I think are really important to highlight and recognise. The first is around about clusters in areas of focus and accreditation. We recognise that Scotland can't be good at everything, but what we are good at, we need to be the best in the world at. And that central concept lies at the heart of this strategy. The four areas have been spoken about, but frankly, they are so broad as to be almost meaningless. What's really important is the 11 subsectors that are identified in the strategy at quite a specific level, because that's the areas where Scotland genuinely can be world-leading and beat all comers. The cluster accreditation process is to ensure that that happens and that those clusters are developed to become best in the world, and also other clusters that emerge over time in our rapidly changing technology environment have the opportunity to do likewise. The investment piece is critical, and the funding review, I think, lining up behind those clusters is really important to make sure that we put our money where our mouth is and drive that potential forward. Wide adoption across the SME base of innovation activity is absolutely central to drive productivity, and that's been highlighted by a number of speakers. And so, again, that programme to take that forward is absolutely critical. And finally, I want to talk about the public sector and its role, because that has a number of aspects that are central to the strategy. First of all, as an enabler in making sure that the infrastructure is in place to support the development of innovation at the cutting edge and more broadly. And I would recommend, if you only look at one thing in this strategy, flick through and have a look at the maps, because they're an excellent, ready, handy guide to all of the immense amount of work that's happening in Scotland across all of those key areas. Secondly, making the public sector itself more innovative, and I would encourage the Minister to make sure that that part of the strategy isn't left and not taken forward, because the public sector is a significant part of the economy, and as we all know, there's a huge amount more that can be done to make it innovative right across all its aspects. And then the next point for the public sector, and this was mentioned correctly by Daniel Johnson, is the public sector as a customer. This is covered in the strategy. It highlights the work already of CivTech, of the Scotland Innovates Portal, of SHIP in the health sector and so on, but more has to be done to take that forward and leverage our procurement spend. And then finally, of course, measuring, which is absolutely critical. The report, the annual report of the scorecard, to make sure everything is on track across that wide range of metrics that are all important to developing and delivering on the innovation strategy, needs to be driven forward as well. So I'm sure the government will take all of those points on board and propel Scotland to be a leading nation when it comes to innovation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms McKee. I now call Murdo Fraser to be followed by Marie McNair. Mr Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome the debate this afternoon on the innovation strategy and the wider issue of driving innovation in the economy? And as we've already heard, Scotland has a great history in terms of innovation. In the 19th and early 20th century, we were arguably among the most inventive nations in the world, with Scots innovators and inventors producing world-leading breakthroughs in the fields of science, engineering, mathematics and medicine. And both Kenneth Gibson and Keith Brown gave us examples of famous names in these fields. So there is a great legacy for us to build on. And the focus on innovation at this particular time is much needed. Economic growth in Scotland is sluggish. We know that our growth here has been roughly one half of the UK average in the years since 2014. Had we grown the economy at even the average rate of the UK in that period, we would today have more jobs, better pay and, crucially, more tax revenues. So it is in all our interests to deliver a growing economy. And in that connection, I was pleased to see it explicitly stated in the innovation strategy that the definition of innovation includes activity with the purpose of helping to solve societal challenges or delivering economic growth. And we don't often hear this government talking about economic growth, perhaps because the junior part of the coalition government is actively and explicitly hostile to the concept of growth. And if we are now seeing a new approach from the Scottish government that is about embracing growth, then that is very welcome. But it will need policies put in place to actually deliver that growth. And too much of what we've seen from this government in the past has been anti-growth. It's been about hiking taxes in Scotland and stifling economic activity with excessive regulation. It's not just growth we have a problem with, Presiding Officer, it's also productivity, or rather the lack of it. This is not a problem unique to Scotland. It affects the UK economy and indeed most European economies to a greater or lesser extent. And as we've debated in this chamber many times before, we are currently in a situation with a very tight labour market, both in Scotland, in the UK and across the Western world. We know that Scotland is not attracting our fair share of immigrants from the rest of the world, and we lag behind every region of England, apart from the North East, in terms of our attractiveness to new immigrants, particularly important when net immigration into the UK today sits roughly double where it was prior to Brexit. And these shortages in labour are driving businesses to innovate from necessity. Let me illustrate this with just one small example. A pharmacy business in my region I was talking with recently. Now, the work of pharmacists includes producing, on a weekly basis, blister packs of pills for patients, which, particularly for those with complex medications, is absolutely essential to ensure they're taking the right pills in the right order at the right times of day. And the preparation of these blister packs is time-consuming and laborious, and precision is absolutely vital. Traditionally, this is done by hand. And this pharmacy practice was struggling to recruit the staff with the skills and the focus required to do this repetitive work. So instead, they've invested in a new piece of equipment, an expensive piece of equipment, but once set up and programmed, will now prepare these pill packs on a mechanised basis with 100% precision. This is a real productivity gain through innovation. It does come with substantial upfront capital cost and investment, but it allows the members of staff presently employed on this important but repetitive work to be redeployed elsewhere and provides a better and safer service to patients who are the business's customers. It's a good illustration of how innovation can deliver productivity improvements for a small business and help tackle labour market challenges. Presiding officer, there's much more I could say about the role of universities in particular. The new £100 million innovation fund is welcome, but University Scotland are questioning whether it's new money or simply repurposing existing investment streams. It would be good to get clarification on that from the Minister. I would need to recognise the importance of the Scottish Government working with the UK Government in these areas. If we are wanting to see our ambitions about improving innovation delivered, that will only happen if both our governments work together. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fraser. And I now call Marie McNair. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scotland has a rich history when it comes to innovation, and it is important that whilst we celebrate the achievements of the past, our focus is firmly on the future. Neighbouring countries such as Ireland, Denmark and Norway have shown just how successfully innovative small nations can be. It is crucial that we follow their lead and prioritise putting innovation at the heart of a thriving Scottish economy. If we don't, we risk being left behind. The strategy we're debating today is undoubtedly exciting and bold. We know that in Scotland we have some of the finest research institutes, colleges, universities and businesses in the world. However, what has been missing is a coherent strategy linking all of these elements together. A proper roadmap spelling out how to turn research into successful products and businesses, and then how the Scottish Government can support scaling up. In Clydebank, we have seen firsthand how innovative technologies bring benefits to a community. For example, the Queen's Quay development features Scotland's major first water source heat pump system, heating water from the River Clyde and distributing it to customers through a district heating network. This project was supported by the Scottish Government's Low Carbon Infrastructure Transition Fund. It is a fine working example of research being turned into a successful product supported by the Scottish Government and delivering real benefits to my constituents. I hope that with the implementation of this strategy, more successes such as these are seen right across Scotland. I often hear from businesses with great ideas, but their biggest challenge is securing the funding to deliver. Therefore, I'm particularly encouraged by the focus on routes to invest in this strategy. Generating funding from private enterprises alongside ring-fencing further public sector spending will be vital if this strategy is to be successful. In my constituency, I have been working with the Malin Group on an ambitious project to deliver a Scottish marine technology park. This would provide a unique environment for world-leading innovators in the marine industry, allowing them to create a self-sustaining ecosystem that will reinvigorate shipbuilding in renewable industries on the banks of the Clyde and beyond. However, the key barrier to development is funding, and I'm pleased, therefore, that this strategy outlines how the Scottish Government will work with projects such as this to bring investment they need and drive collaboration with key partners. I would also welcome the renewed focus on the positive contributions our colleges make to the innovation ecosystem. I think too often they have been deprioritised, but I'm pleased that colleges such as West College Scotland in my constituency are at the heart of this strategy. Every business I speak to talks of skill shortages, so it's important that we support our colleges as they work to provide Scotland with the skilled workforce it needs to drive innovation. In Scotland, we have the natural capital, talented workforce and sectoral strengths to build a thriving economy. However, too many of the powers needed to deliver our vision lie at Westminster. We need to be free from Brexit and right-wing immigration policies that harm our economic and social prospects. Change isn't coming from Westminster.
The member is concluding. The member is concluding.
Tories crashing of the economy, and there is really no change promised from Labour either. The Labour amendment refers to a pledge from Keir Starmer on the so-called GB energy, but we know the pledges this man make quickly disappear into the wind. To further maximise our economic prosperity, we need the full employment, energy and revenue-raising powers devolved in this Parliament, meaning Scotland will no longer be held back by the UK Government. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. And we will now move to closing speeches. I call on Paul Sweeney on behalf of Scottish Labour. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I'm pleased to close this afternoon's debate for Labour, and I'm keen to emphasise the importance of innovation across our economy. Many members today spoke about the historical pedigree of Scotland and innovation, but I'm afraid that picture is one that has faded considerably, because if we even look at patents, for example, we are just a quarter of the European average in patent density in Scotland. And I think the root cause of a lot of that comes back to firm generation. We simply aren't generating the velocity of firms in this country, which are owned in this country and headquartered here, to allow us to have the sovereignty over industrial growth that we really need to get back on track with all our metrics that we've talked about today in terms of productivity, product development, exports and patents. I think these are all critical and they surround the firm. The firm, of course, the joint stock company, was the great innovation of the Industrial Revolution and of the Scottish Enlightenment that gave Scotland that huge global head start. Great examples where, you know, we talked about Glasgow, many members have discussed the engineering genius of this country. It was engineers, scientists getting together with entrepreneurs and canny investors all coming together in close proximity that cracked the industrial leads that we need. So there's many opportunities in the country today. Certainly the strategy and the innovation strategy focuses on, for example, life sciences and health. The BioQuarter in Edinburgh is certainly a great asset, but we can't forget life sciences expertise and innovation potential across the country. Glasgow in particular, a great ecosystem innovation taking root. I had the pleasure of visiting the University of Glasgow's new Clarice Pierce School of Health and Wellbeing recently, which has brought together academics working to address health inequalities. And it will also be a key aspect of the Glasgow Riverside Innovation District, which was mentioned by the member for Glasgow Kelvin. So there are huge opportunities. Happy to give way, yes.
I thank the member for giving way. Could I also take the opportunity to put on record, Mr Sweeney, the 450 new jobs at the West of Scotland Science Park, a £30 million investment in molecular science from Merck, who are investing in my constituency to make Maryhill a centre of excellence within that field for innovation.
Paul Sweeney.
Yes, the Merck investment announcement was great and, you know, a good example of, you know, high quality, high value jobs. You know, but I again lament the fact that there's not a Scottish headquartered company driving that investment in Scotland. That's the fundamental thing we always come back to. And it's that issue about ownership. Though it's great and we can't deny that. And it is an opportunity for us. There's two practical challenges. Let's take the strategy in the abstract, but then drill it down into practical applications. One of the most rewarding things I've been doing, working with a number of members in the chamber today, is forming the cross-party group on shipbuilding. Obviously, I have a personal background in the shipbuilding industry. And whilst we've focused very heavily on naval shipbuilding, but also ferry building, there's a lot more to that. And the key to that is Scotland, the opportunity of Scotland in driving that huge procurement into value propositions that can build companies in Scotland. And, you know, I'm really concerned that we're potentially going to miss two critical opportunities. I want to just cite them today for the benefit of the Minister and hopefully can work together to capture this opportunity for Scotland. Ultimate Boats, they are already building on the Clyde and need to expand. They need to move to a larger site. Moving to a larger site on the Clyde would mean Ultimate Boats could build 500 vessels a year and create 300 high-quality jobs. But their current lease runs out in May 2024 because the landlord wants to redevelop the land for housing. They have a couple of suitable sites identified, Scotstoun and Inchinnan, but are struggling to engage with the landlords to agree a lease. They have put in £7 million of capital for the current owners, but they need £10 million of extra investment. They've had interest from several buyers, as their current lease is up next May. They're unable to find the funding. They will not be in Scotland as of the 1st of January 2024. A move to the United States is likely, who are willing to invest £10 million for a 5% equity stake and likely to have a £100 million return within 5 years. Or Poland, with a European investor ready to put in £30 to £40 million for 30% equity. Invest Northern Ireland, similarly keen to bring them to Belfast with the promise of grants. What's happening in Scotland? Scottish Enterprise seems disinterested and SNIB won't support them essentially because they're too small. It's not acceptable, Minister, and we need to get a grip of this urgently. This is a critical, tangible output that we need to secure for Scotland now, within the next 6 or 7 months. The Cross-Party Agreement Shipbuilding has been working to identify these opportunities. We've got huge opportunities with the products they're developing. Sea trials recently on a new counter-terrorism craft for Hampshire Police, who lead on counter-terrorism for the UK police forces, weren't very well. Police Scotland diving teams, anti-terrorism units also taking part. They can build these vessels in as little as 2 weeks. They could be a market leader in this field, but they are likely to leave the UK for the US or Europe unless they can secure this funding in debt or equity this year. It's time, it is of the essence, Minister, to secure these opportunities. Similarly, we've got the Zephyrus project, a tripartite consortium, AMC, who are an aluminium boat builder, Shift to make batteries and Ecomar propulsion systems, have agreed to join together to retrofit crew transfer vessels to service offshore wind farms. They're trying to set up a facility in Montrose or on the Clyde, and they were looking at potentially the Mallin-developed Scottish Marine Technology Park facility at Old Kilpatrick, but unfortunately, timescales are currently unclear for its completion. We need to help them find a facility. Ecomar need 15,000 square feet, AMC need quayside access, and Shift need 7,000 square feet for a battery factory. They need 2.5 million, Ecomar needs 2.5 million in equity and 2.5 million in debt to get into propulsion software hydrogen integration in a factory. AMC need £10 million over 2 years to start to build a yard on the Clyde, and to create potentially up to 2,500 jobs. Shift batteries need £5 million to set up a battery facility, but for a larger 300 megawatt plant, this would be £20 million investment needed in debt. So basically, for £30 to £45 million of investment, the Clyde, Scotland can have a yard, battery factory, low emissions propulsion manufacturer, making the area a global leader in zero emission crew transfer builds to service Scotland and global export markets. I urge the Minister to meet with me and the Scottish National Investment Bank to move this on. We cannot afford to wait any longer on these key investment decisions. Zephyrus waited a year for a reply from SNIB. My understanding is that SNIB's focus may simply be on larger companies.
Mr. Sweeney, you should be bringing your mics to close, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. So we really need to get on with this, and I hope that we can seize this opportunity for the good of Scotland. Time is of the essence.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. I now call on Liz Smith to close on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms. Smith.
Thank you, and I do welcome this document that's been published by the Scottish Government. That's because it is a much-needed outline of the route map to make Scotland a world-leading small nation for innovation, of which we are definitely capable. But I think Daniel Johnson made a good point that we've been a long time waiting for this, and nonetheless, we broadly welcome the steps outlined in the strategy which is necessary to grow the sector. And likewise, we support the decision to develop an innovation scorecard which will measure the success of this strategy by comparing Scotland's innovation ecosystem with other comparison nations, because I think that's very important when it comes to inward investment. Now, various members have said that Scotland has for centuries punched well above its weight in technological innovation. But the surrounding investment infrastructure is now a problem. Ivan McKee was quite right when he said that that is absolutely essential in the public sector just as much as it is in the private sector. We've raised some really key points this afternoon, but by far and away the most important of any of them is the need to complement the ambitious innovation strategy with economic policies which make Scotland the most attractive place in which to live, work and invest. And to date, despite the Scottish Government's very blunt acknowledgement in the foreword that Scotland's productivity has been lagging behind, we simply do not have these economic policies in place to properly address this. So when the Minister refers to stickability, I hope he will recognise that that has to be something that changes to relate to the policies that Murdo Fraser described in his speech. because the current tax structures do not bring in the necessary revenue to drive growth, with considerable increases expected in Scottish Government's expenditure over the coming years, especially in health, social care, social security. The current tax structures definitely need reform. The Scottish Government claims that this is all about progressive taxation, with obviously threats to increase income tax even further. Business, however, will tell you a very different story, because they believe that that is about making Scotland less competitive, and that is a big worry when it comes to new innovation. Government ministers tell us that when we look to Scandinavia for some of the best practices, that that's about innovation. I think that's true up to a point about innovation, but it's certainly not true when it comes to tax policies, and we need look no further than Norway to see what has happened with the investment potential. And I think Paul Sweeney made a good point too about new patents. As the Scottish Government has also acknowledged, not nearly enough of our enterprises are innovating, and those who are finding it difficult to expand. So I think the Scottish Government has a really big question to answer about why that is, because it's all very well having a national productivity programme, but that must come alongside the right economic policies to create growth and create stability. And that includes ensuring that the... yes, of course.
Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Member, for giving me that point. Does she recognise that perhaps one of the big constraints is access to capital, that simply it's very difficult for Scottish businesses to organically access capital finance in this country, and often the only alternative is to basically put themselves up for sale overseas?
Liz Smith.
Yes, I do recognise that. I think the capital aspect of this is absolutely vital. I think, at least I hope, the Scottish Government's taken a few lessons this afternoon about what we have to do with capital infrastructure. And I also think it's very important that they listen carefully to what our universities are saying, because to be quite blunt to Keith Brown and Ivan McKee, it's all very well talking about the outstanding work that is going on in our universities. That is very, very clear to all of us who know them. But, you know, we only have to listen to what Professor Dame Sally Mapstone is saying when the Scottish Government is clawing back 46 million of promised expenditure in tertiary education. That innovation can only be there if there is a well-supported, excellent research. And she posits the idea that Scottish universities are not there to manage decline. And that's a quote from her. Because these are quite strong words, I think, from University Scotland. Do I have time?
You have 3 minutes, Ms Smith.
Okay.
Ivan McKee.
So in the same speech, Liz Smith talks about we need to reduce taxes, and at the same time she calls for more spending. Can she square that circle?
Liz Smith.
Yes, I can, because we made suggestions at the time of the budget about where we would make some savings, and we will continue to do that, Mr McKee. But success is all about Scotland's two governments working together, and I'm not quite sure why there were some murmurings on the SNP benches at the time when one of my colleagues mentioned that, because I think that's what the public wants to see. And I think that is something that, particularly in difficult economic times, the last thing that we want is a divergence of opinion between our two national governments. And I think, you know, it's welcome to see what the UK government is doing, but it's also welcome to see what the Scottish government is doing. And I'm getting a bit tired in this chamber of this constant... constitutional bickering that is going on, because the public wants to see success. They want to see us working together, and they want to see delivery in that respect. Now, we should not underestimate the scale of the financial support that is required when it comes to innovation, and that's why it is vital that there is a joint approach. I think economic growth is absolutely critical. I don't understand why the Greens are so intent on opposing economic growth to do all the things that they talk about when it comes to social well-being, etc. You won't have that social well-being unless you have the fundamental economic growth that then underpins that social well-being. And I just don't understand the Green position on this, and I don't think some of the SNP understand the Green position on that either. So to conclude, we very much welcome the publication of this much-needed strategy. But I do think if the government has any chance of making a success out of it and harnessing all the vital potential that Scotland undoubtedly has, we have to ensure that it's complemented by the economic policies that make Scotland an increasingly attractive place to live and work, and most importantly, to invest.
Thank you. And I call on Richard Lockhead to wind up. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's been a good debate, and I'll do my best to cover some of the themes raised by members from across the Chamber. And I think we can all agree, and we have agreed in this debate, that Scotland is a country famous for ingenuity, invention and innovation. And we've played a role over the centuries in shaping the future, and here we are today with a vibrant innovative sector and research and universities and institutes in our country, as well as entrepreneurs who once again are putting in great work to shape the future. Indeed, in many ways, the future here is here already. And I think we have to be very important when politics enters those debates, because there are absolutely amazing things happening in Scotland at the moment, and we should be broadcasting that to the rest of the world and talking about them over and over. Even when you think about the fact that the world's most powerful telescope, the James Webb Space Telescope, which is now sending back those breathtaking images, going back to the beginning of time, if we can get our heads around that, back to the beginning of time, and one of the key instruments on that, the infrared instrument, was developed here in Edinburgh in a project led by Professor Julian Wright. That is what Scotland is contributing to humankind at the moment. And there's many other examples which others have cited in terms of what's happening in the economy and the business community and the health system and so on. And I have to say, I think some of us remember Scotch and Rye, and I think that the Reverend I Am Jolly has been reincarnated in Douglas Lumsden. The fact that he could deliver such a negative doom and gloom speech in this debate, I think was actually out of sync with many of the other contributions across the chamber who were talking up Scotland's achievements and what's happening in Scotland at the moment. And there's been a lot of talk about productivity, for instance, and it's really important to note that Scotland's long-term productivity growth has outperformed the UK as a whole. Between 2008 and 2021, productivity in Scotland, for instance, has grown at an average annual rate of 1% a year compared to the UK average of 0.6%. And the level of productivity in Scotland is now estimated at 97.6% of the UK average, which means we've now got the gap down to less than 3%. So there's more to be done, but we are outpacing the rest of the UK. I'll take the intervention.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way. And I agree that we shouldn't be wholly pessimistic, nor should we be blindly optimistic. So the herd numbers do put us above the UK average, but would he address the point about BERD, and would he acknowledge the fact that in 2020, Scotland had just 251 patents granted? So does he recognise that that is the challenge that we have in front of us, and could he set out what he thinks will do to drive up those number of patents?
Minister.
Well, what we set out to do to address some of the challenges as outlined in the National Strategy for Innovation that we're debating today. And in 2020, Scotland's gross expenditure on research and development as a share of GDP was above that of the EU, which was only 2.19% compared to Scotland's 3.13%, and we were also above the OECD, which was only 2.67% in 2020. Also, Scotland ranked first amongst the OECD countries for its higher education R&D spend as a percentage of GDP back in 2020 as well, above the rates for the OECD and for the EU and indeed for the UK. And in terms of the latest UK Innovation Survey results from 2021, they show that in Scotland, 33.5% of collaborating innovative businesses did so with a university or other higher education institute, which is the highest rate in the whole of the UK. And the European Commission's Regional Innovation Scoreboard assesses the performance of 240 regions across the continent, and Scotland was classified as a strong innovator with its performance improving. And indeed, we were ranked in the first quintile of that as well. So there's lots of reasons for optimism, but as the strategy lays out, there's a lot of room for improvement as well. We want to match the best. We don't want to settle for where we are. We want to match the best. Now, Ivan McKee and others addressed the issue of...
Murdo Fraser.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. I wonder if he would address the point that I raised referencing University Scotland, who were asking whether the £100 million new innovation fund is new money or just recycling of previous announcements.
Minister.
We introduced an increase in the research funding for universities, but the £100 million fund is a university initiative, and it's really important to bear that in mind. But Ivan McKee and others raised the role of the public sector, because it's not just about private business, and I think a number of members across the chamber raised that. And it's important to say that the Scottish Government's CivTech initiative is the world's first successful public sector-focused innovation accelerator and is already regarded as an exemplar initiative and has been described as a gold standard public sector innovation driver. We've also got the Supply Chain Development Programme, which uses public sector procurement to improve the capability of Scottish manufacturing chains. Also, one of the Tories had the audacity to say that the rural communities are not mentioned in this strategy, which is complete, total, utter nonsense. The National Innovation Strategy recognises existing expertise right across Scotland, including our regional strengths across the Highlands and Islands and throughout the south of Scotland, from harnessing our natural capital assets in terms of renewable energy to also revolutionising dairy farming and agricultural practices, which was mentioned by some members as well. So the future of all of Scotland and our rural communities is at the heart of this as well. And we're not starting with a blank sheet of paper. This government created 7 innovation centres. We've got the Data Lab, we've got the Industrial Biotechnology Innovation Centre, we've got the Centre for Sensor and Imaging Systems, we've got a Centre for Aquaculture, we've got one on the built environment, we've got the Digital Health and Care Innovation Centre, we've got Precision Medicine Scotland as well, and of course the National Manufacturing Institute. And as a whole, the whole of the public sector, it invests £430 million a year in innovation. We're also outperforming the UK in the creation of green jobs. We're also outperforming the UK on exports and a range of other areas. So it's clear that all that investment in innovation is paying dividends for the Scottish economy. Myrtle Fraser, Jamie Halcrow Johnson, Martin Whitfield, others mentioned the potential for innovation and what it's delivering in health and social care. And there's some fantastic examples. Myrtle Fraser mentioned one in relation to pharmacy, and there are so many others as well. NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde are investigating the potential of using products using AI to detect a variety of cancers from thin slices of human tissue from a biopsy that are treated with chemicals and traditionally examined under a microscope to detect cancer. So there's innovation throughout the whole of the NHS at the moment. There's also in the private sector, we've got many global challenges being addressed through innovation. IGS, one of our companies, is an award-winning international agri-tech innovator delivering indoor vertical farming solutions to people and customers and businesses across the world and also contributing towards our net zero targets. And we've got Spirit Aerosystems, one of the world's largest manufacturers of aerostructures for commercial aircraft and defence platforms and regional jets. And their facility in Prestwick has been established as a centre of excellence for research and development of advanced materials and digital manufacturing technologies and processes and so on. And they're just some of the examples of the great innovation that Scotland's capable of by seizing the opportunities that we have. I also think the space industry, which we debated recently in this chamber, is another exemplar of innovation. We have an ambition to grow the space sector in Scotland to 20,000 jobs by 2030 and grow that to a £4 billion share of the space industry globally. And that is a really exciting, innovative sector at the moment. It's paying dividends. I was at the Farnborough space event just a couple of weeks ago. I spoke to companies from all around the world who were at that event, who knew it was happening in Scotland. And in terms of the cluster approach being adopted by this innovation strategy, they saw themselves as wanting to relocate to Scotland or invest in Scotland to become part of that cluster approach. And that's why the cluster approach is so important. It will be a magnet that will attract many companies from around the world.
Mr. Forgiving Way, it makes a really important point about that clustering effect, and one of the big opportunities identified in the debate was about maritime in Scotland and the two companies I mentioned. Would the Minister refer to those companies in his closing remarks and offer to try and make them succeed in Scotland?
In conclusion, Minister.
Yeah, I don't have time to address all these sectors, but of course the maritime sector has great potential for innovation as well. The space industry, as I just mentioned, is one of many sectors which is also an exemplar of the benefits of inward investment. And for some of the Tories to say that it's really important that Scotland becomes an attractive location for investment, can I say to the Conservative Party, we are already a very attractive location for investment. We're outperforming the UK, and we're outperforming the UK, the EU as well. Scotland's foreign direct investment projects, as announced yesterday, outpaced growth in both Europe and the rest of the UK for the second year in a row. Scottish projects were up by 3.3% in 2022, compared to, wait for it, a 6.4% fall in the UK.
Minister,
and only
a 1.4%
increase
in the rest of Europe. So I think we should congratulate all these innovative businesses in Scotland that are leading to those record-breaking results for inward investment projects in Scotland. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I just want to say we can be proud of this new strategy. Yeah. It's a 10-year strategy. When we look back in 10 years' time to now, we will be proud of all the achievements of Scotland's growing economy, growing high-value businesses, and the contribution that innovation is making to humankind and the planet and Scotland's quality of life and wider ambitions. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scottish innovation strategy. It is now time to move on to the next item of business.